need a place I can elevate my soul, where my mind and spirit can be whole, where the truth is real and greatness is a norm.
I need a recipe for a greatness meal, where there's love and care and God is real. I'm addicted to the top, still I want more. The elevation, yeah, making greatness common, elevation.
Thank you, viewers, for joining me on the broadcast today. It's such a pleasure to have you. I'm sure you've been having a great time the first 2 months of this year. And as we move to the third month of the year, I trust that God's grace will abound over you like never before. The things that you're wishing for, God is going to bring them to pass. I will be discussing the message today that I've titled, Build Your Altar. And I know that this message is going to be a blessing to you. Why am I sure about that? This is because the subject matter of today is a very interesting one, the altar. The big question I have for you today is, do you have an altar? Do you have a place of connection with God? In the Old Testament, altars were built as a memorial unto God when there was a divine intervention, when someone experienced a divine intervention. Some other times, God asked for an altar to be built for you to be able to see divine intervention, to see his hand move in a particular situation. In the New Testament, James chapter 5 verse 13, the scripture says, is there any afflicted? He said, let them pray. One translation, New King James translation says, is there any suffering? He said, let them pray. That means prayer it brings a remedy. It remedies situation. Then how do you pray when you don't even know the God that you are praying to? How do you pray when you don't have a point of connection with God? These are the things I'm looking at today. I'm attempting at bringing you closer to God, especially in your prayer life, by encouraging you to build an altar to God. I'm trusting God to make this a blessing to you, and I want to encourage you to invite your friends, your family. Let them join us. Let's discuss this together, and I know this will be a blessing to you. I'll be back shortly. Happy viewing. Praise God. 2 Samuel chapter 24, I read from verse 10. And David's heart condemned him after he had numbered the people. So David said to the Lord, I have sinned greatly in what I have done. But now I pray, O Lord, take away the iniquity of your servant, for I have done very foolishly. Now, when David arose in the morning, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Gad, David's seer, saying, go tell David, thus says the Lord, I have offered three things. I offer you three things. Choose one of them for yourself, that I may do it to you. So God came to David and told him, and said to him, shall 7 years of famine come to you in your land, or shall you flee 3 months before your enemies while they pursue you? Or shall there be 3 days plague in your land? Now consider and see what answer I should take back to him who sent me. Verse 22, now Arauna said to David, let my lord the king take and offer whatever seemed good to him. Look here, here are oxen for burnt sacrifice, and threshing implement, and the yoke of the oxen for wood. All these, O king, Arauna has given to the king. And Arauna said to the king, may the Lord your God accept you. This was the response of the king David. Then the king said to Arauna, no,
but I will surely buy it from you for a price. Nor will I offer a burnt offering to the Lord my God with that which cost me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. And David built there an altar to the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord heeded the prayer for the land, and the plague was withdrawn over Israel. I say one more time that in 2013, every plague is withdrawn from your life. In the name of Jesus. Wherever the hand of the enemy may want to rest, the Lord my God is taking away the hand of the enemy. Whatever has touched you, touched your household, or touched anything that belongs to you, and it has hurt you in the past year, in this new year, God's hand is resting upon you. And because the hand of the Lord is upon you, every plague is withdrawn. In the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Let me tap your neighbor this morning and say, build your altar. Build your altar. Say to somebody else, say, build your altar. Build your altar. All through the Old Testament, you see the patriarchs of faith walking with God, building altars to God from time to time as occasions would demand. In Genesis chapter 12, God called out to Abraham, come out of your people, out of your kindred. Go to the place that I will show you. And the Bible says, and Abraham departed. And when he got into a particular place, God said, stop here. This place I will give to you and your descendants after you. The Bible says, when Abraham heard that, he built an altar unto God. Built an altar unto God. Ladies and gentlemen, we're examining this morning the altar. And I want to give you reasons why you must build your altar in 2013. In the Old Testament, there are all kinds of sacrifices. The sacrifices always will take place at the altar. And when you look into the life of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, you always see the altar from time to time. And in the New Testament, Jesus also taught us to build our altars. This time around, not physical altars. So I'm not suggesting that you should construct a shrine in your living room. Because a lot of us here are used to African religion. And you know, some of the people that you have to do business with this year, they have their own altar also. Yeah. They have their place of sacrifice. I tell people everywhere I preach around this nation, will you rather build your altar to God and serve the true and the living God? Which one is easier? For you to proclaim the name of Jesus and build a vital relationship with God? Or to carry calabash on your head and move from, start from first roundabout Admiralty Circle, you drop one there, you walk to second roundabout, drop another one, and move from roundabout to roundabout. Sometimes they tell you to walk naked in the middle of the night. When people beam their light, you feel like entering in the ground. Somebody may be asking, Pastor, how did you know? Well, I saw it in a home video. Praise God. That's the kind of environment we live in, where people believe in witchcraft and sorcery, and they do all kinds of things to appease the gods of this world, to make things work for them. But one thing you must know, certainly this morning, is that when you are still at that realm, you must understand that even in the realm of darkness, they have hierarchies. So if you appease this god, somebody with a bigger god in that realm will still come and deal with you. So you have to go from level to level. You have to seek a bigger one. And if you are still at that level this morning, maybe there's still one person. All I'm saying this morning is come into a vital relationship with the one and true God, the invisible, the immortal, the only wise God. the God of our Lord Jesus Christ. The God that said we should approach him with the blood covenant. The blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary. The blood of the atonement. The blood of the sinless Son of God. He said, I'm tired of blood of bulls and cattle, you know, and all that. Approach me with the blood of my sinless Son. And when Christ hung on the cross, he said, it is finished. It is finished. What has finished? An end to all physical blood, human sacrifices. Now we build an altar to God in our heart, in the place of prayer and supplication. And God is saying, come us stronger. Come up stronger. You see, our natural ideology of prayer in this part of the world is a time to deal with your enemy. In fact, some people pray, and they pray 30 minutes, and they won't mention the name of God once. They just continue to talk to their enemies. And you see, I need to understand this morning, when the disciples of Christ approached him, they literally asked him, Lord, how do we build our altar? That was the question. They said, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples, talking about John the Baptist. Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. What they're saying is, as New Testament saints, how do we build our altar? What should be our understanding of the altar that we're supposed to raise to God? In Matthew chapter 6, when you read from verse 7, this conversation between Jesus and his disciples. And when you pray, Jesus was talking to his disciples, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do. For they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them. For your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. In this manner, therefore, pray. You see, before David built his altar, God already decided what he wanted to do. He will relent. But there's a righteous requirement to put that altar in place so that the hand of the adversary may be withdrawn permanently. I hope you understand what I'm saying. There's nothing like praying that God will do what he has decided to do. Your answer is express when you ask God to do what he has decided to do. Can somebody say with me this morning? So Jesus gave this guideline that we call the Lord's Prayer. Some people recite it literally. If it's just to remember it, it's okay. But if you recite it literally, it doesn't do anything, really. It just keeps it in your memory. That's the best you get when you recite it literally. It's a pattern of how I should build my altar to God. And if I really want to build an altar to God, then I need to do it the way God wants me to do it. Is somebody still with me this morning? So he says, when you pray, pray after this manner. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I said, can I get an amen?
Amen.
From this instruction from Christ, it suggests that the altar is a place of connection. That the altar is a place of connection. If I want to build an altar to God that will secure my destiny, secure a vital relationship with God, I must understand that it's a place of connection. So prayer for me is not what I do as a ritual. Prayer for me is what I have to do because I'm building a relationship. Jesus said, pray after this manner. All through 2013, have you planned out how you are going to interface with your Father on a consistent basis? That's what I'm talking about this morning. There are things that God has proposed to do in your life. He needs your contribution. And part of your own contribution is to raise an altar to him. And I'm talking about the altar of prayer. The altar of prayer. the altar of prayer. James chapter 5, when you read verse 13, the Bible says, is there any afflicted? King James Version. The New King James Version says, is there any suffering? At this point, in 2 Samuel 24, Israel was suffering, even though it was brought to them by the sin of the king. But the way to stop it is to raise an altar to God. And the Bible says in James 5 verse 13, is there any afflicted? He said, let him pray. Prayer, therefore, is the New Testament altar of the believer. It's not something I do when there's a plague, when only there's a problem. It's something that I do to avert a problem. A prayerless Christian is a weak Christian. We say 7 days without prayer makes one weak. Not W-E-E-K. W-E-A-K. It makes you weak. You become vulnerable. You are a weak Christian. You lack power. Power to make things happen in the spirit. And that's why I'm encouraging you this morning. It's time to build your altar. It's time to build your altar. The altar is a place of connection and affection. Our Father who art in heaven. Fatherhood there. Father talks about my root. It talks about my identity. It said, our Father who art in heaven. Because life may push you around so much, you forget where you're from. When you think of your connections, you only think of connections from your hometown and your town's people's club, you know, and people you went to school with. You'll be thinking, who can bail me out? Have you asked who can bail me out from my real identity, from where I'm from? Because when it comes to it, God can send an angel, just like he did at the threshing floor of Arauna, to stay the hand of the adversary. I hope you understand what I'm talking about this morning. But it takes a consistent altar for you to be able to leverage on such an identity. Our Father who art in heaven. Our Father who art in heaven. Our Father who art in heaven. The altar is a place of connection. A place of identity, a place of affection, where we remember that we are not alone. Remember that you are not alone, that God is with you. The altar is also a place of worship and reverence. Worship and reverence. Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. When was the last time you called God another name apart from God? When was the last time you sang a song to God on your own? Not in church. If you have a consistent altar, then it's a place of worship. A place where you surrender all to Him. The altar is also a place of consecration and surrender. Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Say, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's a place where we say, Lord, let your will be done in my life. I cease from my struggles and I can allow you to have your way. I know you have plans for 2013, but have you dropped it before God to say, Lord, have your way here. Have your way in this. Do what you want to do here. Just have your way. It's when we get to the altar, when you have a consistent place of connection. A consistent place of connection. A consistent place of connection. That's when you can have the opportunity of consecration and surrender. Jacob wrestled with God one night. Wrestled when it was about the dawning of the day. He realized that he had been wrestling with God. He said, I will not let you go until you bless me. But God got him to a point where he knew he could not help himself. Remove something from his joint. So he was limping. He needed help. Even in the physical, God made it clear to him that you have come to a point where you need to build an altar and consecrate yourself afresh. Somebody here this morning, maybe you went through a rough patch in 2012. It may be a signal that God is telling you that you need to build an altar to me in 2013, and this must be a place of surrenderedness and consecration to my will. You went about everything your own way, you lost a joint. And you have a limp to show for it. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning. But it's time for you to, you know, make this thing stronger with God. Build an altar with God, to God. Jesus also made us realize that the altar should be a place, our only place. And when we think of divine assistance and divine provision, is at the altar. The arm of flesh will fail you. Woe unto him whose focus is on the arm of flesh. Bible says it shall be like the heath and the forest, the shrub. It will not enjoy. It will be in the parched places of the heart. But when you focus on God, and what Jesus was saying here is that the altar, when you build your altar, it's a place. He said, give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses. Look, give us this day our daily bread. What do you need in 2013? Are you consciously, do you have a plan to build an altar unto God where you bring it to him? Jesus said in one place in the Bible, he said, healing, for instance, he calls it the children's bread. Right? And here he says, give us this day our daily bread. Anything that I need, whatever leads to my sustenance, whatever leads to growth in my life, I can ask God for it. I can build an altar before God. When you lack an altar, you begin to look to man to meet your needs. Instead of talking to God about your issues, you talk to man. That's what happens. Because you don't have a personal altar where you speak to God consistently. Is somebody still with me this morning?
Welcome back. I trust that was a blessing to you. I'm sure God is igniting your heart to draw closer to him in the place of prayer. Before this year comes to an end, in fact, before the month of March is over, I am trusting God that you will start to have a powerful testimony of answered prayers in the name of Jesus. If you're far away from God, if it looks like what I've shared today is not connecting with you, perhaps because you are not even sure that God can answer your prayers, I'd love to pray for you. Sin is the only thing that stands between us and God. It creates a wall of perdition between us and God. That's why sometimes you even pray, but it looks like your prayer is just hitting the ceiling and coming back to you because you are not sure that God is at peace with you. Would you want me to pray with you today that God will forgive your sins, that God's Spirit will come into your heart, that you will be born again, born of God? I love to pray with you. I want to bow down your heads and let's say a word of prayer together. Father, we thank you. We ask for your grace over every viewer saying this prayer with me today. I ask, everlasting Father, that you forgive their sins, that you cleanse them from every unrighteousness and give them a new beginning with you. We'll receive a new beginning for everyone in the name of Jesus. Thank you because their sins are forgiven. We ask that you send your Spirit into every heart in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you very much for saying that prayer with me. I trust God to visit you like never before this season. My encouragement is that you create a place to meet with God. It may be in your room, it may be in your office, it may be while you're driving to work, it may be while you're on the bus going to work. Create a time, space where you can connect with God. A time where you say a prayer to God, morning, evening, you know, or afternoon, whenever. The encouragement is that you pray as you go. God answers prayer every time, everywhere. I love to invite you, if you don't have a local church of your own, where you are a worker or a leader, I want to invite you to visit us at the Elevation Church. The Elevation Church is at the Pistis Center, number 3 Remiolo Ude Way, off the Lekki second roundabout, Oniru in Lagos. If you live around the city of Lagos, you are visiting Lagos, I want you to come and fellowship with us. Be a part of the new things that God is doing. The last Sunday of this month, the 31st of March, we're going to be starting the third service. God is blessing the Elevation Church, and we are growing in the spirit and growing in number. And I want you to join us. New service times will be 7:30, 9 o'clock, and 11 o'clock. Join us in any of these three services, and God will touch your life in a very, very powerful manner. Between now and the 31st of March, our two services still remain, 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock. I look forward to seeing you at any of these services, and keep being a blessing to your world. Please stay tuned, because I have another message for you about the great things that God is doing at the Elevation Church. Please enjoy this as you watch. God bless.
My name is Femi Johnson, and I'm a banker. In my line of work, I often deal in large transactions on behalf of my clients that can run into billions of naira. Sometimes, being in that kind of environment where money flows so easily can separate you from the harsh realities of our society. Nigeria is a country where majority of its citizens live on less than 150 naira a day. Think about it. 150 naira. How can they possibly survive? The truth is, they barely do. And so, when the opportunity came to join other crusaders to bridge that divide, I gladly jumped at it. With God's help, we set out to make a difference. Elevate 200 is more than a handout. It's a mission to discover, uplift, train, protect, and support at least 200 less privileged Nigerians each year. We aim to get them from a place of destitution into one of meaningful, gainful employment. I can never get enough of seeing people who were once hopeless take definite steps into a life of meaning. For every one of them that through God's help makes it off the streets, I know that in my own little way, I'm making greatness common.
My church is a place where I meet God and He meets me.
My church is a place of healing, grace, and relationship.
My church is beautiful.
It's a place where there is mercy for me.
My church is full of grace.
My church is a place to grow spiritually and receive testimonies from God.
It's a place where my kids have a great time learning, and I know they are growing in the knowledge of God.
Join pastors Godbert and Bola Akinlabi along with a family of real people on Wednesday, 6:30 p.m. and Sundays, first service starts 8 a.m. and second service 10 a.m. All at the Pistis Center, 3 Remi Olowode Street and New Lekki Second Roundabout, Oniru, Lagos.